Jesus reigns. Glory to God. So let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, we bless your name. We give you glory. We give you honor right now as we get ready to teach your word, oh God. We bless you, Lord God, because we know that you'll send the word that's needed for our hearts in this day and this hour, oh God. We believe you, Lord God, for miracles, signs, and wonders to follow the teaching and the preaching of your word, oh God. And even as it follows, oh God, we believe, Lord God, that we will continue to be empowered and able with the grace of you, oh God, upon our lives, no matter where we are, no matter what we do. We believe that your word is true for us right now. So we believe right now in Jesus' name that this is the word in due season. In Jesus' name, let us say amen. Get your Bible, Zechariah, the fourth chapter. Amen. Hallelujah. Zechariah, the fourth chapter. I'm ready to get right into that word this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. We've been talking about the year of the double grace of God. Amen. 25 years. That's what it means. Grace. Amen. Glory to how many have been shouting grace, grace to your situation and scenarios? How many of you seeing something different happening in your life? Some things change in your life. And I want you to know, don't get so moved by the things that you're seeing in the natural, but you need to be able to see those things from the supernatural. Don't get so caught up into what people are saying, because you can't go by what people say. They'll talk you out of your miracle. Amen. So Zechariah, the fourth chapter, starting with verse number 6. Amen. Glory to God. It says, then he answered and spake unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. And he goes on and says, who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain. I did tell you last week to take out Zerubbabel's name and just put your name in there. Amen. So when you read it, you can read it out loud. Amen. It says, who art thou before Lucius? Thou shalt become a plain, and he shall bring forth the headstone thereof with shoutings, crying, grace, grace unto it. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, the hand of Zerubbabel, have laid the foundations of this house. His hands also shall also finish it. And thou shalt know that the Lord of hosts has sent me unto you. For who hath despised the day of small things? Who has despised the day of small things? For they shall rejoice and shall see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel. With those seven, they are the eyes of the Lord, which runs to and fro through the whole earth. So we've been talking about the year of the double grace of God. Amen. We've been talking about the year of the double grace. Amen. We've been talking about the year of the double grace. Amen. I'm trying to get y'all to say it out loud. Amen. Because if you don't give sound to what you believe, you'll go home all but be defeated because you got your mouth closed. Faith speaks loud. Faith is it moves. Glory to God. It's demonstrative. Amen. So grace is defined as the unmerited favor of God. It is God's free and spontaneous action taken to meet humans' need, especially in providing salvation and enabling the believer. It's an enablement for the believer. We access this grace by faith. In other words, if you don't have faith, your grace can't work for you. If you don't have faith, grace cannot work for you. So what did I just say? We access this grace by where? By what now? By faith. So that means faith is what? It's necessary, but what is faith? It's what you believe. How you believe God. How you believe God. You got to believe God for your miracle. How you going to believe God? You access the grace of God. Well, you can have a problem in a situation, but the reality is the grace of God needs to be on you to carry you through that circumstance or situation. Amen. But if you don't have faith to get through it, then you can't access the grace. Are y'all with me? Jump over right quickly to Romans, the fifth chapter, because I want to show you something here. Romans, the fifth chapter, the very first verse, it says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. Being justified by faith, we have what now?
Peace with God.
We've been justified by faith. We have what now? It says, through God, our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into what?
The grace.
Into the grace wherein we stand. wherein we stand. So no matter where you are today, no matter what's going on in your life, the grace of God is on you, but it's going to be on you based on your faith in God. Huh? You cannot have the grace without the faith, because the faith activates the grace. I say the faith activates the grace. Faith activates the grace. So that means that you got to be able to do something. Not so much with your natural eyes, not what you're seeing in the natural, but you got to allow your faith to activate grace that's on your life. God has given every born again believer grace. The grace of God is available for us in every area of our life. And God is our source, and he is able to supply our needs according to his riches in glory. But he's also able to make grace abound toward us. But we got to have faith to do that. Are y'all with me? So that means that you can't be shouting to no mountains if you don't have faith. You can't be expecting nothing to change in your health if you don't have the faith in God for it to happen. Glory to God. You get what I'm saying? Because you need what? You need the faith in order to what? We need this grace to be activated by our faith. Everybody understand that? Let's just say, I need grace. So that faith can activate the grace in my life. I want to make sure I got it right. Amen. Let me say it again. So I need faith so that grace can be activated in my life. Everybody understand this? Glory to God. We talked about four kinds of graces. Let's talk about the first one, is saving grace, over in Ephesians. Glory to God. He says, you don't get good to get God. You know, you're saved. You are saved by faith through grace. Are y'all get that? We are saved by what now? Faith through grace. Amen. It's not the gift of what? It's not. Let's go to Ephesians 2. Glory to God. Because everybody, I want to make sure y'all got this. Amen. Hallelujah. Woo-wee. You can't ever say what folk got and what they don't understand. Amen. It says, for by grace we're saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. It's a what now? Glory to God. So you receive it. Amen. You have justifying grace. That's a grace that says, you know, just as if I never, ever sinned. And I know that, you know, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So you ought to be praising God. Amen. There is such a grace that's available to you. Then there is a teaching grace. That grace of God appears to all men so that we can live right through this world of worldly lust. Amen. So that means that we don't just sin just to be sinning. Are y'all with me? But we live our life according to the word of God. Then there is the enabling grace of God. And this is a grace that helps you overcome difficulties in your life. This is a grace that is efficient for you because it is God's enabling grace, which allows you to do things that otherwise would crush other people. Are y'all with me? So praise the name of the Lord. So when we think about this, we said that, you know, over in 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, the 8th through the 10th verse, Paul had some things that was going on. And, you know, he sought the Lord three times, and he asked that it would depart from him. And God said he wasn't going to let it depart from him because he had the grace to go through it and win in every area. And I know there's some things in your life right now that you wish you can just don't have to deal with. Anybody in the house this morning? Can y'all do something with my sound? I just feel like it's just too light or something. It's real light. Give me a little lows, a little bit more something so that I could feel a little bit better up here. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. It's feel a little canny. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So that means that, you know, we want to come to this place where we understand that grace is sufficient for us. God's grace is sufficient for us. His strength is perfect in our weakness. Even when we don't want to travel or go on. Anybody ever get to that place? Sometimes you just don't want to go on. But the bottom line is grace is available for you. Somebody shout, grace is available for you. Anybody have those things where so many things come against you and you got one thing after the other, after the other, after the other? The enabling grace of God is there to help you, to see you through. Amen. We used to sing a song back home, back in the church, ask the Savior to help you, comfort, strengthen, and keep you. He is willing to help you. He will carry you through. Not only will he carry you through, but he's going to enable you to endure whatever it is that you're dealing with. Amen? So that means that no matter how tough your scenario was this week, I don't care. You're not beat down. You're not beat up. You got the grace of God on your life. And let me tell you something. It's not about shouting you this morning, but it's about encouraging you through the word of God so that you can understand that I need the word to help renew my mind so that I can move on to my next level. Amen. So tell your neighbor, say, you still can't sleep in here. You got to pay attention. Go ahead and touch it. Say, no sleeping this morning. You go to bed at night. Glory to God. But you up on the morning time. You come to hear the word of God. Touch him. No sleeping in here. Glory to God. Just mess with you. Everybody go act like they're awake now. Amen. So let's go back to Zechariah because there's a lot of foundation that I want to teach you. And I want to make sure that we get this because we hadn't had a chance to really shout grace, grace, you know, from the teaching aspect. I know y'all been shouting around your house. Grace, grace. Grace, grace. Grace, grace. Amen. But I want to give you something to shout about because I want you to see just what happened with Zerubbabel. Amen. We're going to dig this morning into the history. We're going to dig into the history, glory to God, so that we're able to really understand, get more wisdom concerning this whole scenario. So let's go back again. Verse number one in chapter four, it says, and the angel, y'all get me? Hallelujah, glory to God, amen. And the angel that talked with me came again and waked me as a man that is waketh out of his sleep and said unto me, what seest thou? And I said, I have looked and behold a candlestick all of gold with the bowl upon the top of it. I'm hearing an echo and a ring now. And his seven lamps thereon and seven pipes to the seven lamps which are upon the top thereof. And the two olive trees by it, one upon the right side of the bowl and the other upon the left side thereof. So I answered and spake unto the angel that talked with me, saying, what are these, my Lord? Then the angel that talked with me answered and said unto me, knowest thou that these be? And I said, no, my Lord. Then he said and spake unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might. Yeah. Glory to God. He broke it on down and said, not by might. And I'll need you to say it. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. I'm glad that you're enthused. Amen. But prophetically, when the Lord speak, always listen so that you can get the rhythm so that whatever God wants to do, it could be done corporately. Amen. So when God is moving in that direction, allow the movement. But when you take it and you mess it up because you don't know what God's going to do. Now, I'm not saying that God can't move through you, but the spirit of the prophet. Amen. We should be subject to that. Amen. Which means that when someone is standing, you let them move and you let them flow the way they need to flow. You become a sponge so that you can hear the word of the Lord and you can get the directions of God. Now, if I ask you to sing something by the Holy Ghost, you'd be, oh, I can't do it. Are y'all with me? Now, that's a very mild rebuke. Amen. In a way to help you understand, that's how we grow as a church. Glory to God. And the Holy Ghost told me to do it. I looked around. I don't see but one musician in the house, so he wouldn't have been able to catch it by himself. Glory to God. Amen. We need the whole team ready for that. Amen. Because if God gives something, we want to be able to receive it. Are y'all with me? Praise God. So not by might, nor by power, but by thy spirit, saith the Lord. Who did he say this to? He said it to who now? He spoke it to Zerubbabel. And why did he speak it to Zerubbabel? Because Zerubbabel was in a situation where he was rebuilding Jerusalem. And he had a lot of things that was opposing him. And because he had those things that was opposing him, there was a lot of stuff that was coming in against him to the point where if you didn't know any better, it would have been so easy to quit. But the bottom line is, here comes the word of the Lord by the prophets of God. And it's no better time to get the word of the Lord when you're going through frustrations and times of testing. Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I said, there's no better time to get the word of the Lord when you're going through frustrations and times of testing. Is there anybody going through any testing this morning? Is there anybody been frustrated this week? Glory to God. But let me tell you something. You got to now replace again Zerubbabel and put yourself in this picture. And let it be known that the word has come, not by might nor by power, but by thy spirit, said the Lord. He said, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. He goes on and says, who art thou, O great mountain, before Zerubbabel, that thou shalt become a plain, and he shall bring what? Forth the headstones thereof with shoutings, crying, grace, grace unto it. Shouting what now?
Grace, grace.
Was he just shouting, or was he shouting and crying? So that means that he was lifting his voice to a level that changed something in his inside. And how many of you know that you can say, grace, grace to it. Amen. Hallelujah. Uh-huh. Glory to God. But nothing will change about you, because God doesn't, so he's not so much interested in you shrinking the mountain, because you can't do it. But he's trying to get you to shift and change in your inside. And your insides need to change. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Every now and then, you need to be able to shake yourself and say, I'm going to decree and declare the word of the Lord. I'm going to open up my mouth. I'm going to begin to shout. I'm going to cry out to God, just like Zerubbabel cried out to God. And I'm going to begin to experience the very thing in my life that need to be experienced. So I'm going to shout out, cry out, grace, grace to it. Yeah, you're fine. So, you know, that's good. I came to work the other day, and I got to the gate. And before I got to the gate was locked. So I decided, I said, you know what, Lord? I want to begin to shout grace, grace to it right now. I want to begin to cry and shout grace, grace to it. So I began to cry and shout grace, 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 grace to whatever mountain that was set in the way of Agape International Ministries. Grace, grace to whatever situation that will try to stop the people of God from moving forward to what you called them to do. Grace, grace. I got in the gate, y'all. Drove on up, glory to God. Got out of the car, and I'm by myself. But I'm like, grace, grace, because I am convinced that if the word of the Lord worked for Zerubbabel, that word would work for me. The question is, do I have enough faith for the word to work for me? Huh? Remember, if I want the enabling grace of God to be on me, that means that faith got to be activated on the inside of me. And if faith is not activated on the inside of me, I'll do things religious. And when I do things religious and I don't get the results that I need from God, then I'll be mad at you, God, and everybody else. But you got to come to the place where it's not about the religiosity of how we do things. It's about the faith in God as he gives us a directive to do things. So when God gives us a directive, we got to be able to move by the direction of God. Hallelujah. Come on now, how in the heck he going to tell Joshua to go and march around Jericho 7 times and don't say nothing until they blow the trumpets? But then when they blow the trumpets, everybody's supposed to shout. It's something about your shout. Yeah. It's something about your shout. But you got to be able to believe in the God that you're shouting to. Are y'all with me? I said, you got to believe in the God that you're shouting to, because I do believe that even when I'm in here by myself, I walk in this building, it's dark. Grace, grace! To Agape International Ministries, whatever it is that's trying to hold us back and keep us from moving forward and doing what God called us to do. Grace, grace to it! Do you understand that Zerubbabel had an assignment? His assignment was very, very serious. But God told him some things that he had to do. Now, let's go back and look at this. He says over in verse number 6, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Now, let me ask you a question. When you get a word like that, even though you got these big mountains in front of you, you just got a lot of resistance in front of you, you still got to have some kind of energy to make this work for you. If you don't practice now, it's going to be very difficult for you when you get home in your private spaces. I said it'd be very difficult when you're home in your private spaces. That's why when you open your mouth and corporately we do it, it helps you. So even when you're in your car, you say grace, grace to it. And you just say grace, grace to it. Somebody come with you some foolishness on Monday, grace, grace to it in Jesus' name. Amen. So you get a call from a relative and they say grace, grace, grace to that situation. When you understand the enabling grace on your life, you pray better. You really pray better. And it's not all about yourself. But you begin to pray and intercede for other folk just as well. Because not only am I shouting grace, grace to my situation, but I'm crying out grace, grace to yours too. And I believe that if God can move the mountain that's in front of me, he can move the mountain that is in front of you. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody shout, I believe that he can do it. So then he answered and spake unto me, saying, the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by thy spirit, saith the Lord. Who art thou, O great mountain? Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain, and he shall bring forth headstones thereof with shoutings, crying, grace, grace unto it. Grace, grace. Wait a minute. It seems like the prophet had already began to prophesy that this thing was going to go. Come on now, look what the Bible just said. It just said that, you know, you're going to take up the stones. Come on now, that's the headstone. You know, usually in headstones, those are the last pieces of stone that goes on a building. He had not even finished the process, but he said, you take up the stone and you begin to shout, grace, grace to it. So what am I saying to y'all this morning? Not wait until it's over, until you get the physical manifestation of what God promised you, but you got to open your mouth and say, I'm going to be just like Jerubbaal. He didn't say one time grace. He said, cry, shouting, two times. Are y'all with me? And as he began to cry, grace, grace, some things begin to shift and change. Now, mind you bet now, things did not just shift right away. Everybody said, didn't shift right away. Let me show you and walk you through what the Bible says. Glory to God. What happened here in Zerubbabel? Glory to God. He's going to make this plain, make this mountain a plain. He's going to smooth things out. But you still got to have the faith of God in you to know that even when you don't see it being smoothed out, you're not going to let what you see stop you from moving to God, what God has promised you. Glory to God. You got to make up in your mind that, you know, he's going to smooth things out concerning area of my life, my business, my life, employment, my money, sickness that's on my body, whatever fear that's trying to take me down, whatever uncertainties that is there. God is smoothing it out right now. And you should be saying, even under the sounds of the man of God's voice, things are being smoothed out. I'm trying to get you to open up your mouth. Because remember what he told Zerubbabel, he said, you cry out, you shout, grace, grace to it. You remember the man who the blind man who was sitting and was waiting on Jesus to come by, and he was crying with the voice of faith, and he kept saying he didn't care what the people said. You know, he was just saying, Jesus, Son of Nazareth. He was speaking the word of God, and everybody, shh, you need to be quiet. He got louder. And that should be your mindset this morning. Nobody know what you're going through. Tell your neighbor, you don't know what I'm going through. I'm going through a heck of a lot right about now. So that means I'm going to open up my mouth, since I'm going through by myself without you anyway. Amen. Glory to God. That's a good one. Amen. If I'm waiting on you to get with me, my shout, I got a problem. Because you can't help me shout out my situation. You can't help me walk out my situation. All by myself. I say all by myself. Glory to God. With God, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost, I got everything that I need. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So let's talk about Zerubbabel's history. Zerubbabel is a Babylonian name, offspring of Babylon. He's a governor of Judah. But Zerubbabel was appointed as one of the initial leaders who supervised the reconstruction of Jerusalem temple with the help of the priest that was there. And you can find that over in Ezra, the third chapter, starting with the second through the third verse. I'm going to go there because I don't want to read all that because it's a lot of history, but I do ask you to go back and read it. After a season of about 14 months to get settled, the Jewish people began to rebuild Jerusalem. It wasn't long before opposition arose and brought about a standstill. Have you ever been in a situation in your life where all of a sudden you were moving and then all of a sudden things stood still? I want to show you, go to Ezra, the fourth chapter, glory to God, the first verse. I want to read this so you can see this because there were so many things that was happening here. And the Bible makes it very clear that when he began the project and when he did these, there became so many problems from within and without. Within and without. And for the scripture said that the people of the land that were squatters that had taken the property. See, y'all talk about squatters in today's land, but you don't understand squatters was way back in Bible days. That's why you cannot just leave your property open to nobody. Glory to God. You got property, you got houses at home. You better make sure somebody is in it and securing it. Amen. I got to give y'all a good one. You know, we got some squatters on this property. We had the church picnic and we saw some honeybees. Some bees were on the property. Y'all laughing at me, but let me tell you. So I called exterminator. And I said, you know, they got to go because they're going to bite somebody. I didn't know what it was. It just was a bunch of bees. So we put out some cones so nobody could, you know, get bitten by the bees. And they said, the firemen said, you're going to have to cut the tree down or you're going to have to get an exterminator to come out. So we called an exterminator to come out. And he came out and he said, Pastor McDowell, we got a problem. These bees ain't going nowhere. I said, the devil is a liar. They got to go. I said, the bees, he said, the bees are not going nowhere. And I said, okay. He said, these are honeybees. Now don't y'all go up there trying to get some honey out the tree, okay? And he said, federal law protects honeybees. He said, they're not going to bite you. As long as you don't bother them, they're not going to bother you. He said, they are breeding honey out there. Now, I know somebody going to go out there today. Where them bees at? I want to see. So you know what I did, right? I said, well, how are we going to get them moved? He said, well, you know, you're going to have to call a beekeeper. I said, a beekeeper? Somebody told me to just get some diesel gas and throw it up in the hole. He said, you can't do that. He said, you'll go to jail if they find it out. I said, what bee going to tell on me? I thought I'd get y'all moving in that regard. So I'm looking at the tree, y'all. I'm telling you, it's a big hole out there in one of the trees. I'm not going to tell you where it is, but I know somebody's going to go out there and see it. And actually, these bees are just going in. And I mean, they're making honey. The queen bee is there, and they say the queen bee have to be removed first so she can carry the colony with her wherever it's going to go. So I told them, I said, okay, then how much that's going to cost? Because my thing is, if we got to pay for somebody to move the bees, why can't we just get a drill and put some a hole out there and just get the honey and sell the honey? And let the bees work for us, glory to God. But the point that I'm making is, if you don't occupy, someone will squat on your property. They won't pay no rent. They will show up as if they belong there. Somebody better shout hallelujah. So go over to Ezra right quickly. I want you to see this. Amen. So in Ezra, the fourth chapter, starting with the first verse, now when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard the children of the captivity building the temple unto the Lord God of Israel, then they came unto Zerubbabel and to the chief of the fathers and said unto them, let us build with you. For we seek your God as you do, and we do sacrifice unto him since the days of Esarhaddon, king of Asher, which brought us up hither. But Zerubbabel and Jeshua and the rest of the chief of the fathers of Israel said unto them, ye have nothing to do with us to build an house unto our God, but we ourselves together will build unto the Lord God of Israel, as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, hath commanded us. Now, he got a directive from King what? Cyrus, to go forth in the project, right? But then all of a sudden, then the people of the land weakened the hands of the people of Judah. Uh-oh. The people what now? Okay, so let me go back to you guys because, again, you know, I'm an instructor in Dynamic Bible Study Methods. Amen. I teach three principles that are very critical, and my students better get it right today. Amen. I'm sending back through the class. Amen. There are three things that we do when we start looking at Scripture. Number one is what? Somebody say occupation, observation. They're nervous this morning, amen. When we observe things, that means that we're looking at the Scripture to find out exactly what's in it so that we can draw some interpretation. Are y'all with me? And after the interpretation, we're gonna look for what? An application. So what are we observing this morning, what we just read? That the people, what? They were what now? They were weakened by the people of the land? That's what you say? Let's read it one more time. Amen. Even the baby's saying, so okay, glory to God. So then the people of the land weakened the hands of the people of Judah. Y'all see that? The people what now? The people of the land, they weakened what now? They weakened the hands of the people of Judah. Y'all see this? Okay. And troubled them in building. Huh? So in other words, they stopped the work. Are y'all with me? They stopped the work. Okay, now it goes on in the fifth verse, and it says what? He says, and hired counselors against him. Come on, y'all, this is amazing. And you think about today's time, you know, and I watch the news sometimes, they say these squatters, when the enforcement comes to get them, they ring the doorbell, and it's like, oh, we're supposed to be here. We got papers. Who gave you papers to be in somebody's house? And then the other day they had another one that was on the internet putting the stuff out, how he enjoying the house. It don't belong to him. And hired counsels against them to frustrate their purpose. I want you to underline to frustrate their purpose. Because anytime your purpose is frustrated, it's going to cause you to what? To slow your roll. He says, all the days of Cyrus, king of Persia, even until the reign of Darius, king of Persia, and in the reign of Ahasuerus, in the beginning of reign, wrote they unto him an accusation against the inhabitants of Judah and Jerusalem. Now go back in mind and know that Zerubbabel has been given an assignment. And regardless of the assignment that he's been given, what's happening here? He's got all this stuff going against him. Y'all see this? Y'all see he got squatters. He got folk who ain't, I mean, they doing everything to frustrate him. It kind of reminds you of Nehemiah. Remember when Nehemiah was supposed to be building a wall? And he had all these people that was coming against him. If you notice, every time when there is someone assigned to build the walls of God or the temple of God back, it's always going to be some folk that's going to come back to try to get them off of their assignment. Are y'all with me? Okay, so I want you to jump over to verse number 24, because there's a bunch of things that take place. They have the counselors, they got attorneys, and they basically, they just making sure that whatever they could do to stop this wall from being restored, so be it, that's what they'll do. Look at verse number 24. Then ceased the work of the house of God, which is at Jerusalem. So it ceased until the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So they were successfully able to stop the work. Are y'all with me? But everybody said, but they didn't stop the work. Because that's when Zechariah came into Zerubbabel and gave him the word of the Lord. I'm going to say it one more time. That's when Zechariah, spoke the word to Zerubbabel to give him the encouragement of the word of the Lord, that regardless of what was going on, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. See, y'all don't get this, because I'm trying to get y'all to be Zerubbabel right about now. I'm trying to get y'all to be in a situation where folk done tried to keep you from moving forward, keep you from going into the place where God said you're supposed to have. I'm trying to get you to the place of understanding, no matter what sickness or disease or whatever is going on, it doesn't matter what the doctors say, it matters what the word of the Lord says. And if you don't have the word of the Lord on the inside of you strong, boldly, that you know that you can do what Zechariah was telling Zerubbabel to do, then it won't work for you. But I'm letting you know that he had all these things that was going against him. And he shouted what? Now go back to Zerubbabel. Go back to Zechariah. Look at the 8th verse. It says, moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, the hand of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this house. His hand shall also finish it. Ah, y'all don't hear that. When it stopped, the word of the Lord came back to what? Zechariah, saying, the hand of the Lord. Come on, y'all. Are y'all see this? Isn't it amazing that even now some of you have begun some things that God told you to do, and all of a sudden you stopped? Amen. You stopped. For whatever reason it was, I don't know that you have squatters, I don't know that you have honeybees in your house or whatever, glory to God, but you stopped. And God's saying, it's time to begin again. Amen. The hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this house, his hands shall also finish it. Your hands shall finish the work that God has place in your midst. You might have had to close some things down for right now, but you can begin again. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. You might have stopped writing. You might have stopped doing all of those things that God have already told you to do, all because of the opposition. But the word of the Lord says you can begin again. So the scripture says, he says, and thou shalt know that the Lord of hosts has sent me unto you. Yeah. I'm going to say, and you will know that the Lord of hosts has sent me to preach this word to you this morning. Yes. You got to begin again. Yes. Get it on your tongue, lips, and vocal. Tell your neighbor, begin again. Yes. Tell them again, begin again. Yes. Say, begin again. It's time now to begin again. Okay, so let's look at the verse. Let's keep on teaching this morning. Amen. So he goes on and he says, glory to God. He says in 10th verse, he says, for who has despised the days of small things? I want to finish the rest of this, but who hath despised the days of small things? Small things. Sometime we want things to be so big before they even start. And God just said, just let me begin with the little bit of you right about now. How is it that you want this big old end, but you got a little old bitty faith? God wants to, he wants you to start where you are and trust him for the increase. God wants you to come to the place of understanding that I'm giving you a foundation, but you got to trust in the foundation that I'm giving you. Let's go back and look at this scripture. I want y'all to read it because I want you to get this. He says, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this house. The hands of Lucius have laid the foundation of this project, this house. His hands shall also finish it. That means that it might not look like it's going nowhere for you right now. It might look like it's just in the ditch right now, but it's not in the ditch right now. It's waiting on you to get it out the ditch so that you can get it back on the road again, glory to God, and do the things that needs to be done concerning what God have told you to do. I don't know all the specifics of it all, but I'm just speaking by the power of God. God says it's time to awaken some things on the inside of you. It's time to awaken your faith right now. It's time to renew your mind right now so that you can really believe him to do great exploits in your life. The great exploits would not be done in your life if you don't awaken your faith, glory to God. This is the grace in which we stand. So he says, for who hath despised the days of small things? For they shall rejoice and shall see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel with those seven. They are the eyes of the Lord which run to and fro through the whole earth. Now the foundation of the small things. Glory to God. Somebody shout, we walk by faith, and not by sight. Now, in this day, the forefathers had got to the place where they saw the foundation in the beginning. And have you ever seen a foundation? I built two houses in a church. And when they lay the foundation don't look big. It looks small. And you'll be out there saying, "How? That looks too small. We should be doing something bigger." But how you gonna do the big when you don't have a revelation to celebrate the small? Tell your neighbor, don't despise small beginnings. See, the problem here was the great men of God at that hour, what they were saying is, we're going to compare some things right about now. And see, that's an error for the people of God, because we never should be comparing ourselves with anybody else. What you build on that side of the city is what you're building on that side of the city. What you build on that side of the city is what you build on that. But what God requires me to build on this side, I am supposed to embrace it and receive it. Hey, glory to God. Lord said, we got to stop comparing things, because just because we don't see it all right now, you don't know what God is doing. So what happened was the priests and all those guys back in the day, they was like, this is not good. It ain't going to be big enough. Huh? They were comparing it to Solomon's temple. And Solomon, y'all remember, he built this extravagant, wonderful place. Wonderful things were supposed to happen and take place. But the bottom line was, it was not the assignment that was given to Zerubbabel. Tell yourself, it's not the assignment that has been given unto me. I got to keep my eyes on God. I got to be faithful to finish this thing. To finish this thing. And regardless what comes my way, I know it's not by my might, nor by my power, but by thy spirit, saith the Lord. I got every right now to shout grace to it. Every mountain got to go. Mountains got to go. Mountains will be made plain. But while they're being made plain supernaturally, you gotta stay in faith. Yeah, watch the mouth, what you're saying. Death and life is in the power of the tongue. Y'all quick to say hallelujah and bless the name of the Lord. Shout out to the book, Shonda, but then you speak a negative word. Every time you open your mouth and say something that's contrary to scripture, what you're saying is you're holding up your progress. You're holding up your progress. You're holding up. I'm trying to tell you, you're holding up your progress. You're holding up your progress. You are holding up your own progress. And while you're wondering why your stuff ain't moving, because your mouth ain't moving right. Hallelujah. So praise the name of the Lord. So I want y'all to see this. Here we go. All of a sudden, he says, over in Haggai, the second chapter, the third verse, he says, y'all go there right quickly, because I want you to see it. Haggai, it's right before Zechariah. Haggai, the second chapter, it says in the first verse, in the seventh month, in the 1 and 20th day of the month, came the word of the Lord by the prophet Haggai. Now notice the word of the Lord keeps coming. I said the word of the Lord keeps coming. Then he goes and says, speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jozadak, the high priest, and to the residue of the people, saying, who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? And how do you see it now? It's not in your eyes in comparison of it as nothing. Uh-oh, the prophet has spoken. The prophet has spoken. In other words, he said, stop looking at everybody else's stuff. But pay attention to what I've called you to do. Now, look at verse number 6, because this is good to me. Glory to God. He says, for thus said the Lord of hosts, yet once is a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land, and I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come, and I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. The glory of this latter house. Oh, yeah, we talk about the glory of the latter house is going to be greater than the former house, but now you know why. Because they were comparing it. They were trying to say the foundation was not big enough. But it's not about the size of the foundation. It's the word of the Lord and the assignment of God that is on the house of God. He says that the glory of this latter house shall be greater than the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, and the Lord, saith the Lord of hosts. Glory to God. Now jump over to verse number 20. And again, the word of the Lord came unto Haggai in the 4th and 20th day of the month, saying, speak again to Zerubbabel. Okay, y'all get it now? Why? Why is he speaking to Zerubbabel? Because Zerubbabel got a little frustrated now. Y'all get what I'm saying? And you know how it is, you start something, then all of a sudden people start gnawing and nagging at your stuff, and before you know it, you know, you start listening to that foolishness, and before you know it, you get disappointed. You get frustrated. That's why the Lord said, lift up your eyes unto the hills. Huh? He didn't say lift up your, he said, lift up your eyes unto the hills. From what now? Which coming my help? My help coming from where? God wants you to take your eyes off of everybody else's stuff. Tell your neighbor, what you got going on, it ain't even my business. I need to stay focused on what God is going to do in my life. I can't compare you to me right now. I love you with the love of the Lord, but I love God more. I want to pay attention to the assignment. I got to get it done. I got to get the job finished. I got to get it completed. Don't you understand when you start looking at other people, you can't even operate in faith the way you're supposed to operate in faith. God has a faith assignment just for you. He has already, he got it already signed up just for you. Nobody can speak to your situation the way you speak to your situation. Nobody can call those things that be not as though they are, except for you, because you know what you're going through. You don't know my story. You don't know what I've been through, glory to God. But you better know that I am not going to get caught up in looking at somebody else and get off of the assignment of God. Because he says, he who began a good work in me, come on, he shall see it finished and complete until Jesus Christ come. So that means that if I started it, and he told Zerubbabel, your hand started this, and your hands are going to finish it. Your hand started this. I hope I'm talking to somebody this morning. Your hands shall finish it. But he said, don't despise the day of what? Small things. We live in a world where small things are not celebrated. Come on. I go to the gym, and you know, I want the instant abs. I want all of that right away. I ain't gonna lie to y'all. I want it all. Glory to God. But glory, it just don't work like that. Amen. Let me give y'all a joke. Last week I was in the gym. This young man, he got up on the bars. I thought he was a gymnast. You know, he was just moving his body and just working and working. And I'm like, you know, here I am on this bike, just riding. Amen. I get my little 50 minutes in there, and I'm like, okay. And he he got to another apparatus. I mean, he just his body just, you would have thought he was a gymnast. I'm like, man, so Holy Spirit, you go over there and ask him how old he is, because I want to know, you know, what you doing that I can't do. He said, I'm 35. I said, that's enough. Thank you. Amen. I said, I'm 62. I stuck my little chest out, you know. He said, well, you look. I said, yeah. I said, but how did you get there? He said, I started this a long time ago. Say, Pastor, when did you start this? About 2-3 years ago. What I do, I can't even compare to what he's doing, because he's been in a regimen of doing this for the last 15 or 20 years. He cut now. I ain't gonna lie to you. He cut the brother's cut. But I'm cut too, glory to God. I ain't cut the way I want to be cut, glory to God. But you understand what I'm saying? If I look at someone else, I'll start looking at myself in a way like, oh man, what am I even coming in here for? The devil is a lie. Am I helping anybody? So, glory to God. Hallelujah. Let me get back to this. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Instant abs, instant drive-through, instant everything, overnight sensations. Well, we want to be beautiful. We want to be, but we don't want to work to get it. We don't want the blood, sweat, and tears that it's going to take to get the jobs done. Glory to God. Come on, y'all. Listen to this. This blew me away here. Everything in life starts small. People, trees, houses, relationships, and even faith. Faith the size of a... It don't grow if you don't nurture it. But it takes time to grow. A garden is planted 1 inch of dirt at a time. A book is written 1 word at a time. A marathon is ran 1 step at a time. A relationship with God is deepened 1 day, 1 hour, 1 minute at a time. We are carriers of the kingdom seed, so we don't have to be afraid to be too small. We don't always see the potential in our small beginning, but God does. Come on now. Mark the fourth chapter, 30th verse. I want to read this. He says, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or with what comparison we compare it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which when it is sown in the earth is less than all the seeds that be in the earth. But when it is sown, it groweth up and becometh greater than any of all herbs, and shooteth out of great branches, so that the fowls of the air may launch under the shadow of it. One seed grows up out of the air, and it causes what? The fowls of the air to rest on it. Y'all see this? Mustard seeds. So, people of God, I'm here to announce, you know, God has great plans for your life. Great plans for your life. Great plans for your life. I'm going to write it out and say it here. The glory of this present house is greater than the glory of the former house. And although the foundation looks smaller to them, check this out. Jesus never walked on to Solomon's temple, but he walked into the temple that Zerubbabel laid. I know it went all over your head. I said, God was preparing something greater because someone greater was coming. So while we get caught up into what it looks like, you don't know what God is doing. So as I'm getting ready to close, Zechariah, the fourth chapter, he says, he brought forth the headstones with shoutings of grace, grace to it. Grace, grace to it. Grace, grace to it. He didn't wait to put the foundation of the stone at the end of the building project. He told him to get the stone, the headstone, shout grace, grace to it. Shout grace. And I know sometimes you don't feel like it. Sometimes, you know, people, you think people are crazy and you think you're crazy. But the bottom line is crazy faith gets you a long way. You know, Bill Winston tells the story of when he was in Chicago and his battery died. And he said he was really busy trying to get going. And he said it was so cold. Anybody from Chicago, you know how cold it is in Chicago. He said he laid his hands on that car and started speaking the word of God. He said, you know, he looked around just to see if anybody looking at him because he wanted to make sure nobody thought he was crazy. But he said, but all of a sudden, he said something rose up on the inside of him that caused him to really release faith into the automobile. See, that's beyond a lot of folk because most folk can say, okay, no. See, and this is the problem here in church. We are failing to teach principles of faith so that you can have that kind of faith, that no matter what comes against your situation, you can rise up and do the same thing. You get what I'm saying? This man of God said he shouted grace concerning that situation, and all of a sudden, what was dead? I said, what was dead? Can you imagine if you picked up your checkbook, which is almost dead? And I'm not saying dead in the sense of having any money, I'm just drying up. If you begin to shout in Jesus' name, grace, grace. Wait a minute, it won't be no different than Jerubbaal. Because what Zechariah told him was, don't wait until you finish the building process. In order to get this thing moving again, you need to shout. You need to cry. Now, wait a minute. Do you not think that with all that we just talked about this morning, that he was frustrated, disappointed? But you got to move beyond your frustrations and your disappointments. I don't have enough. The devil is a liar. See, money's coming from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Huh? Come on. Say, money's coming from the north, the south, east, and west. Say it again. Money's coming from the north, the south, the east, and the west. It's coming into my hands right now. My checking account is overflowing right now in the name of Jesus. I decree and declare right now, grace, grace, Stuart! I don't have to wait now. I'm shouting right now because I'm believing you right now, God, for the turnaround. Things are turning around right now. Turning around right now. They're turning around. So all of a sudden, Zerubbabel began to grab hold of the principle. And the building was built. In about 3 years, he started crying, grace, grace, to the headstone. Then all of a sudden, he had help from attorneys. He had help from governors. He had help from all kind of folk. They were coming from the north, the south, the east, and the west, all because he listened to the word of God, and he began to act on it. Now, this may not be a shout message to you this morning, but this is a message to help you to understand that wherever I'm lacking in my life, grace, grace, that's what I'm talking about. No matter what's going on in my life, I won't walk around this week with my head down and my shoulders rolled back. No. I'm going to hold my head up, glory to God, and I'm going to speak and decree and declare the word of the Lord, because if it worked for them, it can work for you. Somebody shout, grace to it. Stand on your feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Stand on your feet. Hallelujah. Just play me something by the Holy Ghost. Nothing that we know. Hallelujah. Lift those hands up, everybody. Who's got an issue with faith right now in your head? You know, your situation is tough and you can't get it out your head that you can't move forward. Where are you? Are you here? Come here quickly. Come on. Hallelujah. Amen. Stand right here. Right here. Put them heels right there on the line. In Jesus' name. Heels on the line. Amen. Okay, I need somebody moving right now behind them. It's only two of them. I should have two people. You one of the people coming up. Come up. Amen. Come on. Come on. Praise God. Amen. Come on, play by the Holy Ghost. I need the atmosphere created right quickly. Lift those hands up. Is there anybody else? Come on. Is there anybody else? Is there anybody else? Come on, quickly. Come, you see. Don't let nobody put you in up, man. Y'all better get on down here. I need everybody else praying in the Holy Ghost. Come on, y'all praying in the Holy Ghost. Shout out a little boy. Come on. Come on, come on. Come on. Come on, hallelujah. We bless your name, oh God. Come on. I need you praying in the Holy Ghost. Just praying in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Come on. Come on. Is there anybody else? Last time, if that's you, come on. Come on, baby. Come on. Come on. Come on. Don't wait on nobody else. You do what you got to do. That's what I'm saying. Not by power, not by might, by my spirit, say. Thank you.
Thank you.
The power of God in this place? Do you sense the power? Do you sense the power? Come here. Shut up, Oko Shandu. See, when the glory of the Lord, come on. That's okay. Lift them hands up. You all right? If you're not born again, wonderful time to get born again. Hallelujah! Somebody shout hallelujah! Whatever's going on in your life right now, we believe right now that God will forgive you. The opportunity for you to come on. Glory to God. If you're here and not receive baptism of the Holy Spirit and you know you need the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence, let's pray with you while the Holy Ghost is moving. If you're here, don't have a church home, come now. Let us receive you. We would love to have you. as members of Agape International Ministries. Amen. So we're giving you salvation, rekindle relationship, baptism of the Holy Spirit, church membership. Is there anybody? 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 Hallelujah. Well, glory to God. Hallelujah. Were y'all blessed this morning?
Hallelujah.
I said, were you blessed this morning? Hallelujah. I want you to grab somebody. Get somebody. We get ready to get out of here. Come on, quickly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I want you to sing this song with us. Now, bye. Here we go. Say it. Now, bye. One more time. Now, bye. Everybody sing it. Bye.